just as I said, we're live streaming, so we want to start fairly promptly. I'm just waiting for the last couple of people to take their seats, and then we're going to get going. So I'd like to welcome everyone here for this seminar on mission-oriented public investment, state investment banks, and picking winner policies, which is being jointly hosted by SPRU from the University of Sussex, the Joint STEP Centre, and the Business and Development Centre here at IDS. I'm Jodie Thorpe. I'm a research fellow with the Business and Development Centre, and I convene IDS's work on business markets in the state. And I'll be chairing the seminar today. And I think just like to say to the people in the room, remind that we've got people joining us through live streaming through the internet, and to welcome those who couldn't be here but are joining in that way. I think it's really relevant and timely to be talking about the role of the state in driving not just policies, but real transformation in the big challenges of our day, with the climate change negotiations this year in Paris, with the new SDGs. I think that question about how we really drive transformation and deal with these major challenges is has never been so timely. For the Business and Development Centre, I think as well, it's something that goes to the heart of the questions that we're dealing with in trying to look at the role of market systems and how you get transformation in market systems. So we've got people looking at things like micronutrient malnutrition and how market systems can overcome, or what role the state needs to play in helping market systems to overcome that challenge, antimicrobial resistance, sustainable food systems. And we're very interested in the role of both the state and business, and how do these different actors both drive and block change. And my little privilege as chair is to put a plug in for a special issue of the IDS Bulletin, which we'll be publishing on these topics in May. But I think without further ado, to go to the panel, who you've all come to see, and give a quick introduction. Mariana Mazzucato, who many of you will know, is Professor of Economics of Innovation in the Science and Policy Research Unit at the University of Sussex, and many of you will know her for her work on the entrepreneurial state. We've got Caetano Penna, a research fellow at the Federal University of Rio de Janeiro in the Institute of Economics, and also an associate fellow at SPRU. And then in the role of discussant, we have Martin Bell, emeritus professor at SPRU, and he's an economist and historian, done lots of work on the processes of building industrial innovation in developing regions in Asia, in Latin America, and in Africa. And finally, last but not least, Stephany Griffith-Jones, who's an emeritus professor with us at in the business cluster here at IDS, and also the director of financial markets at the Initiative for Policy Dialogue at Columbia University, and her work has very much dealt with global capital flows and financial sector reform. Mariana and Caetano are each going to speak for 20 minutes, and then Martin and Stephany will respond for 10 minutes each, and if we all keep to time, then we should have about 25 minutes for questions at the end. I'll hand over to Mariana.
To move the slides. So I thought when Jody said, I want to make sure that everyone knows we're being live streamed, I thought her next sentence was going to be, so don't swear. because last night we also had a live streamed event, just the audio, for to launch a book that we've just done, Caetano and I, from a conference that we organized this summer, which was actually called Mission Oriented Finance for Innovation. And it got so exciting that, the New Yorker part of me began to use nice, interesting words, including, should I repeat? No, I shouldn't repeat one of them. Anyway, it doesn't matter. We had a Stuart Wood, who's, of course, you know, chairing the for the Labour Party, their new agenda, especially now on the run-up to the election, and he was there. And he actually said something really nice. He said, you know, it's not so usual that actually during the campaign you get new ideas. And he said, what you've actually presented to us is a very different way through which, you know, to think about the kind of things we think we've been talking about. What's this?
Changing the slides.
Changing the slides with this?
Okay.
Okay. Here? God. Okay. Very good. Okay, anyway, thank you so much. We love the opportunity to actually have SPRU type seminars in IDS and vice versa, because we really think that we are, you know, not just the two big brands at Sussex, but, you know, two incredibly dynamic partners. And of course, we are already working together through things like the STEP Center, but there's just so many new ways to work together, and especially we think on these issues, which are really about rethinking the, well, the definition of the market, what is the market, and also rethinking the relationship we actually need to create the markets that we want, the relationships we need between business and government. Okay, so basically what we're gonna do, I have no idea how this works, there we go, is to talk about sort of three things. I must say that we're basically presenting to you two different papers, actually three papers, the third one being one that's not written, and this is the one we actually want to talk to you about the most, so to get your feedback on it. But we're going to begin with a general kind of point, which you just have to believe us, and then, you know, then we're going to develop that point, which is this very limited way through which economists talk about public intervention in the economy. This notion that somehow all you're doing is fixing markets versus actually shaping and actively creating markets is something that people like Polanyi, a historian, we think have, you know, much more to say about than, you know, economists, except some few economists that we will also mention. Then we will give you some examples of this, especially drawing on some of my work on the entrepreneurial state, where the role of the public sector through kind of a decentralized network of different institutions very much created and shaped areas that today we call, say, Silicon Valley, but also with examples of what's happening in China today in terms of their green energy program. Brazil, of course, which we're also doing a project on right now for the Ministry of Science and Technology. During the presentation, we'll give you some examples on that, but we're not going to focus in this sort of initial part just on state investment banks. We'll come to that and argue in the sort of the bridging between point two and point three here that one of the really interesting things today is this emerging role, if you want, of public banks in the innovation landscape, going beyond their traditional roles as just counter-cyclical sort of lending, right, doing what private banks don't do, going also beyond their traditional developmental capital development role, and really operating in what we call sort of a mission-oriented type role, similar to that which has been played by agencies like, say, DARPA, which, again, some of us have written about in terms of what, you know, DARPA did in Silicon Valley, again, cannot be understood just as having corrected a market failure. In the same way, the role that some state investment banks, and I should continue to say some, because I'm from Italy and I can tell you that the Cassa Depositi e Prestiti, our public bank, is not mission-oriented, and I'm actually in talks with them to try to get them to sort of be a bit more courageous and interesting in what they do. And we're really trying to, so what we're trying to do, and this is really what we hope the discussion will center around, is to provide a different lens, a different framework through which to view what these banks are doing. And by the way, Marco is here from SPRU, who's doing a PhD, no? On looking specifically, again, at this mission-oriented role of a particular bank, BNDES. So I'm sure that you can come in with your insights. But what we want to do is provide a different framework, a different lens through which to understand what these banks are doing so that they don't then just get accused of crowding out the private banks, which is actually the current situation. The few state investment banks that we see doing really interesting things, so the China Development Bank, the KfW, BNDES, even the poor little, well, I shouldn't say poor little, they're quite big, but the much attacked European Investment Bank are having problems sometimes to justify what they're doing. So not only to perhaps not do sometimes what we think they should be doing and to act courageously and to really provide what a public bank should be providing, but when they do, they don't have a way to talk about it because the only framework they have is, again, this market failure framework, which then immediately makes them look like they're being too active. Right? If they actually are shaping and creating markets, and yet we have a market failure theory that justifies what they're doing, that actually leads to, in this self-fulfilling prophecy kind of way, the accusation that they're being too active and crowding out the private sector. Okay, so let me move on before I use all my time. So this kind of fundamental question of what should the state do is sort of underlying what we're talking about. And what's really interesting is that Keynes, I would say not so much the modern Keynesians, but Keynes himself, I think really thought very much about this, of course. And he had, you know, pretty poetic ways to express it. And so this phrase here where he says the important thing for government is not to do things which individuals are doing already and to do them a little better or a little worse, but to really do those things which at present are not being done at all. And so in some ways, the debate comes down to how do we talk about those things that are not being done at all? What do we mean by that? And so this other wonderful famous quote, of course, by Keynes, which is that, you know, these policymakers who think they're just on the floor doing stuff and, you know, not being burdened by abstract theory are actually all slaves, he said, of defunct economists. He also had this wonderful second part of this quote where he says, I'm sure that the power of vested interests is vastly exaggerated compared with the gradual encroachment of ideas. In other words, all these people who are so worried about government getting captured, say, by business interests, this is the worst kind of capture when your ideas are being encroached upon by this very defunct theory. We could say that the ambition of this paper, and well, papers, because there are several that we're writing in this area, is really to de-encroach policymakers from this defunct way of thinking of their role in the economy, which can basically be summed up as either the state should simply, or not either, the state should kind of facilitate, incentivize, de-risk, create the conditions for this wonderful, you know, business, entrepreneurial animal spirits, in the case of innovation, create the conditions for innovation through different, for example, types of horizontal programs, science industry links, the right tax structure, and then specifically correct different types of market failures. So what kind of market failures? Well, we definitely don't have time here to give you a lesson on this, and I'm sure most of you have come across this, especially if you've learned economic theory, but you'll remember that, you know, anytime you have sort of positive or negative externalities, when you have something, for example, called a public good, which has positive externalities, where the spillovers are so high, for example, basic research, right? When, for example, I speak, I sound American, but I'm actually Italian, believe it or not. The reason I speak like I'm from New Jersey, which is where I grew up, is that we went to New Jersey when I was very young because my dad does basic research in nuclear fusion, and it's basically just some governments around the world funding that. Why is that? Because, and you know, if they ever, and they always say in 30 years' time, find fusion, it's going to be really hard for any private company to appropriate the returns from that. And so this is the sort of classical area where you need government funding of, you know, blue sky thinking and basic science. And yet what we want to argue is that, you know, if you look at those few places in the world that have actually achieved the kind of growth that so many countries today are after, so the smart innovation-led growth, they have actually benefited from much more ambitious policies which have, you know, operated along the entire chain of innovation, so not just basic research, also applied research, also early stage seed financing of companies. And it's really hard to justify also the quantity of spending, for example, $32 billion a year that the National Institutes of Health in the US spend on the pharmaceutical slash biotech sector just through this apparatus that we have here where you justify public intervention through this notion of public goods, negative externalities, information failures, and perfect competition. And so we really sort of come to Karl Polanyi, who we think has much more interesting things to say, and I'm sure you've read the work of Ha-Jun Chang, who also, I think, cites Polanyi quite a bit, because what Polanyi argued was actually that the capitalist market, okay, forget local markets that have been around for thousands of years, forget international markets, which have also been around for many years, international trade, but the national market, the capitalist market, which is also historically specific, it's only about 300 years old, was actually forced into existence by the state. So this whole kind of distinction, state versus market, and the state should intervene when you have a market failure, is kind of wrong historically from the start. There's this great quote, the road to free markets was opened and kept open by an enormous increase in continuous, centrally organized and controlled interventionism. Administrators had to be constantly on the watch to ensure the free working of the system. And so what I've tried to do in order to debunk, if you want, in my previous work, and this is what we're sort of building on, the sort of Silicon Valley myth, which is the most advanced form of capitalism as it's presented to us, is precisely to show that this constant way that we talk about the state is just facilitating, right? This is a Kafkaian bureaucrat there, making sure we have the right tax system, making sure we are facilitating, creating the right conditions, leveling the playing field in order to nurture this wonderfully creative and innovative private sector is just, again, wrong historically. If you actually look at those few places that have achieved this smart innovation-led growth, where in Polanyi-esque terms, you actually had the state in some ways forcing Silicon Valley into existence. And I don't want to spend very much time on this, but this is in fact the background, and sorry for the self-promotional side here, but the point is that what I then tried to do in the book is really describe that process, and specifically the role of different types of public sector organizations. And again, in the book I focus more on Silicon Valley, but the work we're doing today is looking at similar examples in China and Denmark and Finland and Brazil of public sector intervention, especially in this very high risk, high uncertainty in the Knightian sense, space, financing really what isn't there at all, right? Willing to take the kind of risks that were needed in order to create these general purpose technologies, which economists like to talk about. Why? Because they are the important ones, right? Those technologies that really allowed productivity improvements across the whole economy, which then led to decades and decades of growth. And asking what actually did the state do to enable these things to happen. And so again, I mentioned already this whole notion that what the state has done to allow us to get the kind of innovations that we have, these new general purpose technologies, has been to not just finance the obvious public good basic research, but also lots of applied research, also lots of early stage financing of companies, providing public venture capital. One of the biggest venture capital funds in the US is actually run by the CIA, called InQtel. That's not necessarily something that's gonna make you sleep very well at night. But the point is that all these orange acronyms here are names of public organizations from the National Science Foundation, National Institutes of Health, DARPA, NASA, ARPA-E, which is today trying to do for renewable energy what DARPA did for the internet, which is basically both think about it, have the vision for it, the mission for it, and fund the thing, but also breakthrough technology, really thinking out of the box. And the reason we call this mission-oriented is that if you actually look at the history of these organizations and what they did in financing what later became these general purpose technologies, they were very much results of having a mission, whether it was going to the moon, or if you look at ARPA-E's mission today in terms of trying to really solve big problems around climate change, if you read their websites, look at the words that also the National Institutes of Health use to describe what they're doing, they are not saying our goal is to fix this little problem here or there in terms of the public good basic research problem. They talk about, in their own words, the creation of a new life sciences emerging area, or in the case of ARPA-E, really breakthrough new technologies that do not exist in green energy. Just this slide, I think, is very important, and also Caetano is going to be showing you some, is going to be building on this later. One of the most, I think, surprising areas in this financing is, in fact, this public venture capital role that the state has played, because it really does go kind of way beyond what we would normally justify through the market failure theory. So this is comparing private venture capital money to a public fund, if you want, called the SBIR program in the US, which here has been imitated as usual with much less money per capita. Here it's called SBRI. And what's interesting is how the difference between them, sort of public and private venture capital, has actually grown over time. This isn't intuitive. You would think that in a developed market like the US, you would need over time less and less of this sort of public intervention role if it was being justified just through a market failure framework. Instead, it's growing. And of course, if you know anything of venture capital, you know, for example, they're very exit driven. They want those returns to happen in 3 or 5 years, mainly through an IPO or a buyout. And when you instead think of that whole innovation cycle that I showed you before, you know, that can go from 20 to 30 years. And even the Death Valley period that the VC guys are supposed to be financing can last a long time beyond those 3 years. I won't go through my iPhone example, but this is the theatrical part usually in my presentation where I tell people to take out their phones and throw them away. if you don't want state intervention, just to say that everything that makes your iPhone smart and not idiotic and stupid was in fact financed by the state. You know, the internet, GPS, touchscreen, Siri, all state funded with huge amounts of money that cannot be justified through that sort of classic framework. In the life sciences area, again, as I mentioned before, huge amounts of money that have been responsible for the most revolutionary new drugs, new molecular entities with priority rating. And this is where we get to the paper today, which is that what we started thinking with Caetano was, well, let's go look at what's happening in the emerging green tech area, right? Clean tech, green tech, whatever you want to call it. And what we started doing is we were looking at the studies that we're actually looking at, not just green tech as this big blob that doesn't really mean anything, but specifically, think again of that quadrant I showed you before, who's investing in the kind of highest risk, highest uncertainty, highest capital intensity part of green technology. And when we started looking at the Bloomberg New Energy Finance data, we found, well, there ain't much private money up here in that upper right-hand quadrant of sort of very high risk, high uncertainty. And we bought for a lot of money, and Gregor and I now are questioning whether we bought the right database, because anyway, we won't go into that. We can talk about our experience later. Caetano and I started to look at, you know, the role of different types of institutions around the world, public and private, that are financing the highest risk area of green financing, and found that there was this massive role of public banks. In fact, something like, if you take the whole worldwide, financing of what's called here, climate mitigation financing. So all private equity, all venture capital, all stock market, and all corporate money. Just four banks, so the KfW, number one, China Development, Development Bank number two, the EIB and BNDES together spent something like 8 times as much as the worldwide private sector. And the problem with that is that unless you have a framework through which to understand it, they just look a bit too active, right? What the hell are they doing? Why aren't private banks doing that? Why don't they just leave that room to these wonderful VC guys? And so you have the KfW, one of the most active, especially because don't forget that Germany currently does have a big mission called the Energiewende policy. KfW is one of the core institutions through which they are tackling that mission. So this shows you KfW funding for industrial, environmental, and climate protection projects in Germany. And what's really interesting about this bank, and I'm going to sort of lead on now to Caetano, is that not only are they playing the Keynesian role, which is what, you know, the public sector should not act like business. Do not be pro-cyclical, be counter-cyclical. Otherwise, you get recessions turning into depressions, which is what we've just experienced in large parts of the world. But also directing this money towards a specific area, right? So they're not just doing what Keith Pavitt said, which was pissing in the wind, which he thought was not very useful. They're directing the financing in a particular direction. And the fact that we don't have a way through which to talk about these mission-oriented, directed investments leads us then often to accuse these banks as being too active. And when I was in Brazil last summer in July, in just one day, there was 30 articles in the newspapers using the word crowding out for the Brazilian bank, which Caetano is going to talk about in a minute. Just to give you some figures here for the China Development Bank, which is a very active bank, which, by the way, financed Huawei, which is the number one telecommunications company today in the world, these numbers are massive. The amount of money they're pouring into specific companies in the green tech landscape, of which many fail, right? There's some successes, some failures. Same thing for the US government, funded Tesla, $465 million guaranteed loan, huge success. Elon Musk is our new hero. And Solyndra, $500 million a bust. The statistics, if you look around the world for these kind of investments, is that for every Tesla, you have something like 10 Solyndras, but we're happy when that happens with VC guys. We expect that, right? They're investors, they're entrepreneurs. When the state does that, we say, oh, you screwed up, right? You shouldn't do picking winners. So I'm gonna hand over now to Caetano, who's really gonna focus now on these banks, and we're gonna try to convince you that we really need a completely new framework through which to understand this level of money being thrown at specific areas.
Thank you, Mariana. Thanks everyone for coming. Thanks IDS for the opportunity. So what I will do now is to focus on our paper number one, let's call it that way, which is about the roles of state investment banks in the economy before I get to the mission-oriented role and the picking winners role. So what do state investment banks do? These institutions are known by different names in different countries. So you can call them development banks, or you might call them promotional banks. And what they do has changed over time. And nowadays, some of these banks, like BNDES and KfW, they do all of this. They have a countercyclical role, which is an attempt to offset any credit crunch during economic recessions when the private sector retreats and stops investing in the economy. They fund long-term projects of industrialization and capital development of the economy, which includes also development of agriculture, normally very long-term capital-intensive projects. They might also target investments in high-risk R&D, innovative startups, innovations, or any area that private capital is too short-termist and risk-averse to invest. We call it the venture capitalist role. And fourth, which is a very recent role, they promote investments that help address complex societal problems such as climate change. And that's what we call the mission-oriented role. And what, to be more specific about what is this mission-oriented type of investments and policies, we present you here this table, which comes from a work by Luc Sutter and Arundel from 1993. And they try to compare the old types of mission-oriented projects with the new ones on the right-hand side, which they focus on the environmental technologies. And they have very different characteristics. So before, the missions were defined in terms of technical achievements, like putting a man on the moon, developing some spacecraft that would take men to the moon, or developing the atom bomb, like the Manhattan Project. While the new ones, they are defined about, in terms of economic feasibility of technical solutions to particular problems, not only environmental problems like climate change, but you could also say that obesity or demographic change are the new missions or challenges. The goals and direction of technological development, they were defined by a small group of experts, while now we need coordination amongst different types of stakeholders, not only governments, but especially private sector, who is already doing some technologies that might be even causing those problems, and consumer groups, who would be key to diffuse the new technologies through the economy. It was centralized control, while now it's decentralized control. The diffusion was outside of the core participants and was of minor importance, and right now we need diffusion of these technologies so as to address the problems. Participation was limited to a small group of firms that were selected by government, and now we might have an incrementalist development where you need the whole industry to adopt those technologies. And the project was mainly self-contained, and they were complementary to policies. There was not much attention to coherence between the several initiatives, and now coherence is vital, and you have to pay close attention to other goals. So, in one of our papers, we argue that given these characteristics, the type of centralized agencies like DARPA, the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, is not the most appropriate for this new type of missions. whilst we think that state investment banks, which are already doing these mission-oriented roles, they are better positioned to coordinate, fund, and execute this kind of mission-oriented projects. Why? First, they are banks, so they are able to access economic feasibility of projects. They already provide long-term finance for capital-intensive projects, their second role, which is necessary to diffuse the technologies through the economy. They work as brokers, so they are used to stakeholder coordination. They have a portfolio of funding tools, so they might match the most appropriate funding mechanism to the type of projects, either incremental projects or radical projects. And finally, they are an important actor in the governmental network, so they are well positioned to coordinate with different agencies the types of policies that are being implemented to address the societal challenges. So this is a brief example just to illustrate their roles. You see here, this is the countercyclical role that KfW has played, is the German Development Bank. You see that in 2009-2010, the purple bar shows how they acted countercyclical during the latest economic recession. That is not exclusive of KfW. On average, banks have increased, those development banks have increased 30% that funding during the crisis. And what is interesting, as Mariana has shown in the, one of the slides, is that it was not just credit for like quantitative easing, let's say, like where you just increase the amount of money in the economy and hope that it will go to the right projects. They directed it to particular areas like the green economy. The capital development role that we illustrate with data from BNDES. And you see that the key sources of investments in industry and infrastructure in Brazil is, besides retained earnings, BNDES. Foreign funding, very small, equity, very small, and bonds, very small compared to BNDES and retained earnings. And you see that 2008 and 2009, BNDES also acted countercyclically, directing investment to infrastructure and industry. The venture capitalist role, again, KfW's illustration, an array of programs where they direct credits to small startups and especially innovation programs, projects. And the mission-oriented role, which is the chart that Mariana showed, where you see that development finance institutions, the state investment banks, are the key funder of these projects for climate change adaptation and mitigation. So what does mainstream economics has to say about these roles? So they say, well, it's all about market failure theory. So when you have a coordination failure where actors are unable to coordinate the expectations and preferences leading to this credit crunch, then calls for a countercyclical role. In the cases of public goods and network externalities where no actor has an incentive to invest in them, calls for a capital development role of the state. When you have information asymmetries, adverse selection, where private sector will not invest in certain projects because they don't have information about it or because they are also risk averse to invest in it, then you will have a venture capitalist role. And they would say that the mission-oriented role is justified by negative externalities, like climate change, which can be seen a negative externality of fuel, fossil fuel use. And the problem with this kind of framing and theory is that it brings about certain criticisms. So when the state is too active, it might lead to financial repression where the capital market does not develop fully, the private capital market, and to crowding out when private investors will not invest, not because they are risk averse, but because the state is already doing what they would be doing, maybe. Then you have the issue of misallocation of resources due to political biases, which translates into corruption, favoring allies, and so on. The incapacity to pick winners, well, when they are venture capitalists, the state is not as revolutionary, as efficient to do that. They are incapable of picking winners. And you have the issue of inefficient government structures that prevents the states to really be innovative. Those are the criticisms that are derived from market failure theory. But we want to move beyond market failure because as we argue in our paper, it is not able really to fully grasp the range of the what the state is doing. The problem is not just the underinvestment and risk aversion, which would be a market failure, but it's about underutilization of labor and financialization. So the concepts that are key for this role is full employment, the multiplier effect from Keynes, and the socialization of investments, which are concepts that comes from Keynesian theory and from John Keynes and Hyman Minsky. The second role is not just about infrastructure and knowledge like public goods. It's about creating Schumpeterian rents, about promoting capital development and social capabilities. So the concepts are precisely capital development, strategic trade, national champions, and so on. Key here are the Schumpeterian economists and developmental economists, like Prebisch, Singer, Fishman, and others. The fourth role about venture capitalists is not just about smallness and small SMEs and tax breaks for innovation, but about community development banks in support of the fast-growing firms that are willing to grow and take risks, about R&D and innovation development. And it's a discovery process. It's a learning process. It's not that every investment by the state will succeed. Some will fail, but some will succeed and will bring about big consequences like an iPhone. So it's about entrepreneurship, technical innovation, and again, the neo-Schumpeterian and evolutionary economists are key in here. And finally, it's not just internalizing those negative external costs. It's about making things happen, about, as Polanyi say, great transformations, and about the markets being blind to the kind of developments that we need to address societal issues. So it's addressing those societal challenges, creating visions through missions, and shaping and creating markets. And here, key are Keynes, Polanyi, and the mission-oriented literature. So we discuss the criticisms. So what about them? How do you deal with them? Because they are relevant. You cannot ignore them. They actually do exist. So the crowding out hypothesis is a matter of empirical investigation more than theoretic. Because in most cases, the state investment banks are doing precisely what the private sector is not. And as Mariana mentioned, Marco Carreras will actually look at the empirics of this in the case of BNDES and see what is really happening. And it's about more about full employment, crowding in, dynamizing the economy, making the private sector more willing to take risks, or creating the animal spirits that Keynes talks about, and envisioning. In the case of misallocation of resources, there are implications for how the public sector should be structured, not in opposition to the market, but complementary to them. The state making choices that coordinate private initiative. And then maximizing the absorptive capacity of the state, so to minimize this issue of misallocating resources, which is the incapacity to pick winners. Related to it. And, market failure theory says very little about the cases in which the state is the lead investor and risk taker. On the other hand, Mariana in her book talks a lot about it and shows that the state is the key risk taker and uncertainty taker. So the issue involves a portfolio approach, looking at the picking winner cases from a portfolio perspective where some will succeed, some will not succeed. So key is to see whether the success from a few projects can cover the losses from many projects. And the state learns from what it has lost. What matters in this approach is the institutional structure, ensuring that the winning policies provide enough rewards to cover the losses. And the losses are used as learning examples for the state to improve. And finally, the inefficiency of government structure. The fact that the market failure theory cannot justify or explain the active role of the state it's an issue here, because then it does not see that economic development and transformation of the social techno-economic landscape is a non-probabilistic risk-taking process which entails uncertainty about the technical and economic outcomes. It is a process of experimentation and discovery, as Hishman has said and wrote about, and a continuous process of learning that entails successes and failures. So the focus on strict economic efficiency of government structures is actually misleading. Now, moving to this issue of picking winners, can the state pick winners or not? That's how usually the debate is framed. Can the state pick winners? that's very hot debate. It has been around for many decades. There is a seminal work by Richard Nelson and Langlois. And they contended that governmental R&D support through picking winner policies are doomed to failure, where the state tries to select a project and say, this is going to be the winning horse. It was doomed to failure, according to their analysis. Since then, the widespread view is that governments cannot and should not pick winners. And here we quote The Economist, an article called Picking Winners, Saving Losers from 2010. And they were criticizing the round of picking winners and bailing out policies, saying that the present round of industrial policy will no doubt produce some modest successes and a crop of whopping failures. So, and then that, therefore, the state should not do it. The problem with this view, that's actually, I'm now entering into this paper that we are working on right now. There are two issues. First, the conceptual issue. There's a definition problem. This view lumps together different types of science, technology, and innovation policies, and adopts a very restrictive definition. Second, they have the usual analysis against picking winner or criticisms that end up concluding against picking winner policies are based on a few unsuccessful cases, like Concord, or in the case of the work that we cite here, there is a project called American Supersonic Project, akin to the Concord, and the Operation Breakthrough, which tried to create prefabricated housing sector in the US in the 70s, and they all failed. But they ignored the other ones, like Rolls-Royce, the aerospace division, Airbus, the French fast train, Tesla, Huawei, the internet, biotech, and nanotech. So there is an array of picking winners that we could define that way that is ignored, and they succeeded, and it was all funded by the state and selected and almost created by the state. So what are we trying to do? We are approaching this debate differently. We ask, what can we learn from these successful and failed attempts? And what kind of policy framework would help us not only understand what is happening, but how it might be improved in the future? So we address the definitional problem by expanding on a typology of STI policies. And we are creating a database of failed and successful picking winner attempts and trying to analyze it with this portfolio approach. This is the taxonomy. So we expand on a work and we say that there is not just one type of picking winner policies, but there are four types, depending on whether the focus is on technologies or sectors, and whether the sector or technology is close to market, are they mature enough, or far from market. And in this view, we identify four types of picking winner policies. So we expand on this taxonomy to say, well, not all picking winner policies are equal. I won't have time to go into the details, but the idea is that when, for instance, the technology is very target on a technology, but far from market, then you are creating a vision, and usually you are financing or promoting the project within, let's say, universities or so on. And when you have, for instance, a sectoral focus, but is a mature market, then you are trying to rejuvenate that sector. So think about the transportation sector, where we are trying to make it more efficient. That is the kind of mission-oriented, rejuvenation-oriented policies. And then the analytical issue, we are creating this portfolio approach, so that the pace of picking winner cases, policies that give directionality to technological development, requiring crucial choices to be made. We are not focusing on the outcome of individual cases, but taking this portfolio approach. So we are looking at the institutional structure of it, and we have already 15 cases that we have started to analyze, including Rolls-Royce, a successful one, or the Concord, which is a failed one, and so on. So now I will hand over to Mariana again.
Literally 5 seconds.
You actually have 5 minutes.
Oh, 5 minutes?
Yeah.
What do you mean?
No, just 5 seconds. So just to finish, before we get our wonderful discussants that we're actually very honored to have because they couldn't have been more appropriate, but just to sort of summarize how we think we can really change the debate. That's what I said at the beginning, right? Also our collaboration and also changing the conversation, which I also mentioned, we part of this research has come as an outcome has been actually this book, which we can talk to you more about perhaps in the discussion. But what we're trying to do is really focus on different types of questions and, you know, basically saying that the answers that have been provided have been problematic because the questions were wrong. So the four questions, kind of to sum up, the four relevant questions we think should be, you know, let's get over this sort of very immature problem we have about picking winners. The facts are we have always been picking. We should understand better how that picking occurred, what kind of lessons can be learned. Again, all the technologies behind the iPhone were picked. Today, clean tech is being picked. And shale gas was picked. Shale gas was almost 100% funded by the U.S. Department of Energy. Is that good? Is that bad? That's not the point. The point is, how might we think about public sector directionality precisely because it's so transformational, precisely because your end result is not just having created some little bandages here and there, but actually have produced what Polanyi talks about as transformational change. Perhaps we should have more of a democratic debate about the directionality. For example, we talk about the debt sometimes being too high, right? There's all sorts of debate on that. Where was the debate on shale gas, given that it was taxpayer funded? Two, evaluation. If we are going to have a mission-oriented view, we better have a different metrics. And this is what Caetano has been going on about, but the, sort of the one way to say this is that we better make sure that we have a way to capture the degree to which these public agencies are really creating and shaping new markets. And perhaps, in fact, we should be worried when they're just working within existing confines of how the private sector defines a market. So even the example I gave you of the life sciences sector, is it right for so much public money just to go into drugs? Why not lifestyle changes? Serious research on that instead of a bunch of hippies like us who drink yogurt, do yoga, and go jogging with no proper research on that. Building the kind of explorative organizations inside the public sector. By the way, a really fascinating one to study is GDS in the Cabinet Office in this country. It's incredibly innovative. And the point is, you better welcome failure. If you fear failure, you will not be an innovative public sector institution. But that does pose huge problems with the way that the public sector organizations today are set up. And lastly, this whole point about risks and rewards. If you are going to be, you know, taking these risks, you will fail, fail, and fail again. So let's make sure we don't just socialize the risks, but also socialize the rewards. That could, of course, happen through going back to the kind of taxation system we used to have under the communist U.S. President General Eisenhower, where the top marginal rate was 90%, or when capital gains was still 40% instead of less than 20% once the National Venture Capital Association made it their big mission to lobby for that massive reduction. Or we could actually, for example, either retain equity, use royalties, use income contingent loans, which we use for students. Why not with business? We could also have a better deal with business. Don't forget that Bell Labs itself was set up through a deal where government said to AT&T, we could bash you tomorrow through antitrust policy, but as long as you reinvest your profits back into the real economy, it'll be all okay, and especially towards the big new mission-oriented opportunities. And that was basically why Bell Labs was founded, as a result of this provocation, which is one way that, in fact, we could socialize the rewards, not just the risks taken. Okay, thank you. So great. We're
thanks,
happy
Mariana.
Not to get feedback.
Yeah, and I think you're going to go next.
Thank you very much for the invitation. I'm delighted to be here. I must confess to your bias. I'm a big fan of development banks, and I'm a big fan of Mariana's work. So I will broadly agree with her, but I have some small nuanced disagreement. And also, above all, I want to develop some of the ideas forward which we have been talking about. I read one of the background papers, and I thought it was tremendous, both because it has three very valuable levels. One is the theoretical level, which challenges conventional wisdom. And I think you should perhaps emphasize more that the first conventional wisdom which you challenge is that of efficient financial markets or efficient markets. Yeah? You may have your differences with market failure and so on, but the main fight we have is again efficient markets, which is still in most universities what is being taught, appallingly, after this crisis. And so I think that's the first point. The second point is, in terms of this approach that you have, going back to Polanyi, I think it's very powerful. And I like it very much also because when you talk about financial markets, private financial markets, which I work on a lot, you find that people talk about the markets. The markets did this, and the markets did that, as if they are a sort of living phenomena in their own right, like a tsunami or something. When in fact, it's an institution, which is Polanyi, and you rightly say, we have created. And we can also modify, and we can change, if we get the guts and the political mobilization to do it. So I think this is a very, very powerful. So the theoretical part, I think, is very good. I think the empirical part is also very interesting, because you are outlining what is being done in different development banks. And thirdly, because you have this new research agenda, these questions, which encourage us to go further. I want to start with two personal comments, actually. One is, as I think you know, Franz Kafka was actually my great uncle. And so I know a little bit about him. And apparently, he was not just, although he wrote about them, not just this bureaucrat, but I heard that he, because he worked in an insurance agency to insure workers, he actually invented a special top hard hat that protected workers. So he was actually on your side. The second personal comment I want to say is I started my first job in Chile was at Corfu. And the reason I mention it, because Corfu, I just looked it up today, was actually created in 1939. So it was even created before any development bank in the north.
So I don't understand the word Corfu.
Corfo, Corporación de Fomento de la Producción. So this was a development bank created by Keynesian center-left government, which then was the basis for creating a lot of state-owned enterprises in the key sectors of Chilean development, steel and petrochemicals, and the things that were being done. And for example, I was involved in helping the funding of private investment in forestry. And if you look at the analysis of the sort of so-called Pinochet successes of the free market economy, one of their successes was that they exported cellulose and paper and wood in a very significant way. But nobody says that this was initially funded by a public development bank. And I also mentioned this a bit because I want to come back to this, that this was not so innovative. Planting trees in Chile was just really based on the comparative advantage of soil and climate, but it did turn into a very major export. So just going back to the functions that you have outlined, both of you have outlined so well, I would like to say that I think it's very important that in your work, and in this paper in particular, you have emphasized the financing of long-term strategic investment. This kind of visionary investment, mission-oriented role is extremely important. And I think one thing that you could also emphasize a bit more is the emphasis in accumulating knowledge. And Stiglitz, for example, has a new book on accumulating knowledge. And when I heard him speak about that book, it reminded me that when I worked in the private sector in a bank, I asked for some data that was more than 2 years old. And they said, no, we throw away anything that's too, yeah? So they have no sense of history, their own, the countries, the projects, the sectors. And so I think thinking of public development bank also, you know, as a depository of knowledge, if you go to the World Bank or the EIB or the KfW, you have these people who are engineers who know about the evolution of a particular sector, a particular technology, who have been doing it for years, if not decades, and who therefore, you know, are such a valuable asset. And you just don't find it in the private sector, where they're all financial engineers, not real engineers. So that's a key function. The second function is systemic stability, and you have highlighted the counter-cyclical role, which of course, particularly in the current crisis has been extremely crucial, and it has, as we've evidenced in papers with Ocampo and others, has been true for the World Bank, for the regional development banks, and for the national development banks. And there's a very nice empirical papers by Bray and Schlarig, which shows econometrically how these banks are much more counter-cyclical. But I think also one can argue, if you like, in more conventional terms, that having public development banks, and we've talked about this with Stephen, implies having a more diversified financial system, which contributes to reducing risk. So you're not only diversifying risk within institutions, but you're diversifying risk throughout institutions. If we must have some of this speculative banking, and I wish we had less, but at least we will have institutions that are lending to real projects with strategic importance to the society. I think a third function of development banks, which perhaps you don't you mentioned, but I want to emphasize and develop a bit, is that they can help develop and deepen financial markets. And for example, they can develop new instruments which can then be adopted by the markets. And one that we've been discussing a lot recently is GDP-linked bonds, because they could be useful for countries like Greece. And I should to do a bit of name dropping, but also because he's an ex-IDS MPhil. I've just met with one of the key people in the economics team in Greece. And they are looking, of course, at this option of GDP-linked bonds, which are these contingency loans which are serviced in relation to the moment in the cycle. And you, Mariana, have talked, of course, about capturing the upside. So just to think about it, one can think different kinds of instruments of public-private interaction in financial terms. You can have grants, just give the money to the private sector and hope they do well. You can give them tax concessions. That's the kind of most blunt instrument, which, of course, they love, and they're always lobbying for. Secondly, you can have loans. They can be normal loans that you just pay back in a certain schedule. Or you can start introducing, as you mentioned, some kind of quasi-equity or equity elements, which you can even switch to. So if the company does very well, you say, okay, instead of getting paid back the debt, I'll take back some of the equity that I have contributed. And therefore, then, you participate in the excessive profits. And you could have triggers for that. And then, of course, you have pure equity, which is where you share the risk between the public and the private sector. And I think that this is something that we always, when we meet, say we should write more about. I think it's very interesting, the technical aspect, but also the political aspect, because, of course, the private sector always wants to minimize its risks, socialism, capitalism on the upside, and socialism on the downside, and then wants the public sector to take any losses, but not share any of the profits. A fourth function, I think, which is important and which complements the work that you're doing, and is particularly relevant today in constrained, fiscally constrained Europe, but also more generally, is that development banks allow you to leverage public resources to maximize the impact. So today, with an example I always like to give, with 10 billion euros, you can make 160 billion euros through the European Investment Bank. So you can have a mechanism which leverages investment. And this is important when the levels of investment, at a time when everybody has forgotten Keynes, particularly starting with the German finance minister, you have an insufficiency of demand and insufficiency of investment. One final function I would like to add, which perhaps you don't stress enough, is the inclusion aspect, both regionally and socially. And it's interesting to remind ourselves that the European Investment Bank, which is one of the major development banks in the world, was created because of pressure of the Italian government, who wanted projects funded both through grants and through loans in the Mezzogiorno, because the Mezzogiorno, the south of Italy, was one of the poorest areas in Italy. So, so I have very little time left, so I will be very brief. People usually, when they say that, aren't, but I will try and do my best to be. So the first point, a sort of I wouldn't say it's a criticism, but a nuance is, I wouldn't dismiss totally the language of market failure for two reasons. One is because it addresses some of the people that we want to carry with us. Obviously there are a lot of people that agree with you and me on this strategic vision, but there are people who are more convinced by the market failure argument, and also if you compare it with government failure. So you say, so markets fail, but also governments fail, but in this particular area of strategic investment, governments are better. And not always all governments. And then I think we have to, what we've talked about with Stephen, think about how you get, what are good development banks in the sense that you define, in the dynamic sense. Mm-hmm. And then the political economy analysis, such a pretentious word but useful, about how you get to have good development banks. People say, I'm not sure that it's true, that in sub-Saharan African low-income countries, public development banks are not efficient. So first we have to find out whether that is true or it's a myth of neoclassical economics. And if it is true, we don't have to then say, okay, let's just leave it to these private banks who we know will not fund development. But then how do we get, in that kind of societal context, efficient development banks, both, if you like, in the narrow profit-making sense, but also in the kind of, more importantly, in the dynamic, sense. My final point is, I think one of your many contributions is that you have pointed to the fact that this public investment and development banks is important in all sorts of countries, including in the most advanced market economy, which is the United States. And this is a lesson that's being learned very quickly in Europe because of its counter-cyclical role, but also because Europe is now in the need of a major structural transformation to come out of the crisis. So countries like Ireland, like Greece, like Portugal, now want to revive their development banks. And there is also the challenge from a kind of more IDS perspective of what role these development banks can play, for example, in the low-income countries of Africa and Asia and Latin America. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Jody. Let me start with a couple of introductory remarks. First, as Jody emphasized, I'm coming at this interesting set of ideas and work and so on with a background interest in innovation and industrial policy in the context of emerging and developing economies, perhaps mainly the latter. So I'm not really coming at this with a background in finance and banks and so on and so forth. Second, I'm going to focus my comment really quite narrowly on only one area of the work that's been outlined for us. Does that achieve what we want? Yes. Like Stephany, I kind of carved this up into three chunks. Well, I'm not sure whether they're the same three chunks, but anyway. The first component of what we've heard is a set of interesting ideas about background principles, theory, broad experience of state investment banks and so on. I'm not going to comment on that at all, other than just make brief reference to an Economist article for those of you who like collecting daft quotes from The Economist. I'm going to focus mainly on the second component, the particular activities and programs of state investment banks, as they have discussed, the four categories, four roles, concentrating perhaps on their emphasis on innovation and investing across the entire innovation chain, including in the idea of innovation, the ideas of Danny Roderick about a form of innovation that consists of the discovery of new structure-changing opportunities as being at the heart of industrial policy. I will pick up their ideas about, you know, how all of these sort of components of what SIBs might do might be harnessed, oriented towards mission-oriented, challenge-driven was the other term that they use quite frequently. I'm going to focus in that. I'm not going to touch at all on the third component of more detailed stuff about portfolio development, assessment, management, and so on, important and interesting as those are. This is quite complicated. How do I get this to go when I want it to? Why don't we just do that? It's all right. Yes. Oh.
Next slide.
Yep, on with that. That's a reference that, as I say, collectors of daft quotes from The Economist may want to pick up. On to the next. Yeah? Broadly, my main central comment is about the importance of difference in context in shaping possible ways in which state investment banks might do the sorts of things that Mariana and Caetano are talking about, these challenge-driven funding of innovation. And that's why I kind of asked fairly early on as I was reading the material, what's the context of this analysis? I don't see any very explicit contextual bounding of the work. And this perhaps leads to some degree of inconsistency between two implicit kinds of contextualization that struck me in the work. On the one hand, is the envisaged context for possible activities of SIBs. Where are these activities going to be taking place? And my impression was that the scope of what they're interested in spans a very wide range from the advanced economies through various sorts of emerging economies to the sort of development situations that Hirschman was talking about in the 1960s, 70s, or Roderick talks about now, well down into the middle, low-income economies and so on. But on the other hand, the a second kind of concept. Oh, sorry, context. You're going. You want me to get it done in 10 minutes, don't you? Just keep pressing the button. A second type of context is the context of the insights and understanding that is shaping the way these ideas are emerging, and that's rather particular and rather narrow. In terms of the banks, it seems to be state investment banks heavily in Brazil, in China, in Germany, in Europe. In terms of the projects, it's projects in Europe, the US, and Brazil, and China. Now, that is a rather specific kind of context, a context in which substantial innovation capacities exist. for a long time in some cases, and having been accumulated over the last perhaps 4 or 5 decades in the case of places like China and Brazil, but significant capacities to innovate are present in those contexts, and banks are working in that context. Yeah.
3 minutes.
What?
3 minutes.
To go? Oh, blimey. Right. What I mean is that there already exists not just R&D capabilities and institutes and centres and skills and so on, but of a vast range of other sorts of competences: design, engineering, instrumentation engineering, software development, prototype capacities, prototyping capacities, and so on. And one of the consequences of that is that the financing of innovation is very largely concerned with financing the use of those existing resources. And I suspect that's what these state investment banks are doing as well. Those resources, the competencies, capabilities, equipment, people, organizations, and so on are there. And their use is financed. But in other contexts, of course, that base, that asset base for conducting innovative activity is very different. It's smaller, sure, but it's also structured very differently. A lot of it is concentrated in quasi-public institutes and not in firms. A lot of it is heavily concentrated in R&D and not in the other activities and so on necessary to drive innovation in these sorts of mission-oriented directions. So there is a second kind of financing of innovation that is a relatively modest proportion in advanced economies, but a very important proportion in middle-income economies, low-income economies, which is investment in creating innovation capacity. And not just scale, but addressing issues about skewed structures. Heavy concentration on R&D and very little elsewhere. Heavy concentration on quasi-public institutes and centers of excellence, very little on what is happening in firms and building up innovation competences in business enterprises. So, following Stephany's advice, I've gone back in the history of your favorite development bank, BNDDS, in the days when it didn't have the S. Back in the 1970s, to illustrate what I mean by financing the creation of competence. If I may just...
1 minute.
Oh. BNDS got, well, BNDE, got involved in the financing of a major petrochemical project in Rio Grande do Sul, in Brazil. And in part, this was a standard capital development project, setting up a great big ethylene plant in order to stimulate the development of downstream petrochemical processing and so on. BNDA got involved both as an equity investor and as a debt investor, but there was more to this project than that. It was also a project that was actually investing in innovation. But it was investing in the use of innovation resources in France, because that's where the innovation, that's where the process development and design engineering was going to be taking place. And so, in part, this was financing the use of innovation resources. But beyond that, it was also financing the creation of innovation capacity. Essentially, what they designed was a linked but separate project to create and develop a cadre of basic process engineering and related process design and process plant supply. They pulled together a cadre of people, both from Petroquisa, the technology user, from a Brazilian engineering design and engineering contractor, and from a process contractor, and put together a package of training, learning, experimentation, access to engineering design facilities, skills, competencies, databases, over a period of about a year to 18 months, created this competence. Interestingly, they were sort of picking winners, but not picking winners in terms of new kinds of production capacity, although that was being done at one level. In this other project, they were picking winners in a more indirect way of creating the competence to generate new ideas and find, to use the Roderick kind of language, to discover new opportunities. They created a competence. And so in a sense, it was a more indirect, less costly, less risky, and much more fungible asset. Once you've got a petrochemical plant, there's not a lot you can do with it other than process ethylene or whatever it is it's designed for. Once you've got a cadre of process engineering competence, you can do all sorts of things with that. And so what I think I'm trying to suggest is that across differences in context, there may be really rather important differences in what you conceive of, or what somebody conceives of, these investment banks doing. I would suggest if you're taking your interest beyond the Brazils and Chinas of this world, into the East Africas and Colombias and Perus and Indonesias, then the conversation needs to be heavily about development banks creating innovation capacity, or, to use the Danny Roderick language, creating self-discovery competences and capabilities, and not just worrying about financing innovation via the use of existing resources. That's it.
Thank you very much, Martin, and I'm sorry for putting pressure on. I heard
That's
half of the room every time I said 2 minutes left kind of groan, wanting to hear more of what Martin had to say. But having failed mostly completely in my job as chair of keeping to time, I've managed to leave us with 10 minutes for questions. So I hope there will be some interesting and provoking questions from all of you. Are you going to... I'll take maybe a second time to do three questions and then get response.
Okay, very quickly. My point is kind of parallel to Martin's point. Sorry, McMoore, IDS. My point's parallel to Martin's point, really. At a slightly smaller scale, when you're talking about picking winners, I was wondering what winners are, what are the categories? Because I looked through your list. Some are products, some are clusters of products, some are organizations, some are companies, some are specific technologies. And if I were a skeptic, which I'm not, I'm kind of on your side, I would say, well, you've got a lot of capacity to pick the winners that you're going to pick, as it were. So would like to see a little more kind of consistency in the unit of analysis there, if that's possible.
Jonathan Harwood. My question is really about the extent to which these ideas have found their way onto the political agenda in various countries. My impression is that in the UK one encounters them very rarely, but I'm wondering, for example, if in the US or Germany, because of the evidently greater activity of SIBs there, whether these ideas have found a stronger place on the political agenda. And if that is the case, if there are sharp national differences in the extent to which these ideas are regarded as legitimate and serious, then do you have any views as to why the debate in Britain has been so feeble?
One here. Sorry if I'm
Thank you. Jacques Pézier, BMEC, and retired. Your subtitle, or second part of the title, Picking Up Winners, refers to a methodology to achieve this goal. And I wonder, when are you going to talk about this methodology? And what sort of characteristics should it have? Okay. We are talking about something that should be probably very transparent, that should be subject to a sort of democratic control. There is probably a whole book to write on that. And I was in particular a bit alerted by some little words like non-probabilistic processes or whatever. I don't know if you have anything specific in mind, but to me that sounds very dangerous, and I'd like to see how the judgments about probabilities of outcomes and values of outcomes are going to be used in those methodologies.
Okay, Stephen Spratt, IDS. A similar point, really, to Mick's and also Martin's, but just taking a step back. So before we get to picking winners, we're picking missions to some extent. So how do you choose? It may be that the private sector is not doing something because it's a stupid idea, yeah? So how do we choose what missions to select from a government policy perspective, and how does that vary by country? Because what's feasible for China or perhaps the US is obviously not for other countries. So a little bit more on that would be good.
So, is this working? The first question, which of course related to the question of context, I'm going to say something really controversial, and I'm not sure if Caetano even agrees, but I actually don't think context matters. In other words, that's the whole point in some ways. Across very different types of contexts, what we've seen, and across different types of organizations, we've seen the same recurring methodologies and issues raised. So because we are not actually, or I should put it this way, given our expertise and given what we wanted to look at, context was not the first point, because otherwise you get into the classical thing, which is, oh, we're just talking about developmental sort of institutions that are trying to catch up. What we were trying to say is that even in the US, in a very advanced economy, or in Brazil, which as you say is a middle income country, you know, using sort of existing capacity, the kind of critiques that these institutions are coming under attack with, I can't speak English today, sorry, are very, very similar. And so the question is, you know, And someone critiqued me once recently, which is, you know, saying, well, how can you even compare the BBC to, say, BNDS? Well, I'll tell you exactly how I can compare them. When you have mission-oriented public sector agencies, which is extremely rare, the BBC definitely is one, compared to many, say, public broadcasters, it's amazing the kind of talent you can bring in. It is an honor to go work for those organizations. You know, the U.S. Department of Energy, because it's mission-oriented, had a Nobel Prize-winning physicist running it up until recently. That's unheard of in Europe today, as we just constantly blame the public sector for all the ills in Greece and Spain and Italy. They'll never get out of the rut they're in if that's how we talk about things. And BNDS, the best job you can get if you're a top economist in Brazil, and now that Caetano's gone back to Brazil, we'll see what kind of job he gets, is to go work in that bank. It's you know, they get the best people. GDS in this country, we just had a debate about it in Parliament last week, and this venture capital fund called Passion Capital, which is one of the most important financing high-tech companies, they said, shit, we got a problem. All the best people are leaving the, you know, high-tech companies doing coding, whatever, to want to go work in GDS in the public sector. What the hell's that? And so that's actually what we were trying to look at, which is a self-fulfilling prophecy that the more you talk about the role of these institutions as at best fixing market failures, they are going to fail. And they're going to fail because they can't even bring in the kind of people that will be able to look at those four questions we put up, directionality. The US, it's where was that question? They are under huge problems right now. And not just because some of these agencies are being cut because they're not recognized for doing the kind of things we say they're doing, but even worse, like something that's actually quite sick, which is NASA, which is the most classical mission-oriented agency. Do you know what their mission is today? Commercialization. That's become the mission. Commercialization used to happen almost by accident on the side as you were trying to get to the moon, because you were doing that in a really kind of interesting way. And then all this great spin-out stuff happened. Today, if you read the Space Act today from the late 90s, it's all about creating startups. It's like, why the hell would you want to create startups? You know, I mean, most of them are going to fail. Most won't create any jobs or innovation, et cetera. So, which is the same thing happening in universities, by the way, targeting spin-outs as opposed to doing their proper job and having the spin-outs happen sort of on the side. I want you to do the methodology thing, if that's okay, and talk about that great table we had, which we didn't show you because we were embarrassed, because it's too ambitious, the one where we actually went through how we actually would translate this, you don't remember? Yes. Pretend you do. translate this into concrete indicators of whether we're doing things in a way that makes sense from this mission-oriented, market-shaping, market-creating view. But just lastly, what are we picking? Who the hell cares? Pick it all. We've always picked it all. Technologies were picked. Firms were picked, sectors were picked, broadly defined directions were picked. What we're saying is that's not the problem. The problem is how, you know, what can we learn from the lessons of when those things were done? It's not to say should we or should we not. Tesla was picked, Apple was picked, Intel and Compaq both got that early stage public venture capital from the US government. Huawei got a $5 billion loan from the Chinese Development Bank. Huawei was completely picked. The internet was picked. As you say, these are completely different things, precisely because we're saying get over this problem, this psychological problem, you know, go see a psychiatrist, stop, not you, but, you know, stop talking about should we or should we not pick winners. That's not the question. Our point is it doesn't matter. It's don't ask that question. So maybe we weren't clear on that. We're kind of trying to reverse it. We're saying the question is not should we be picking winners. All these different types of things, and you're absolutely right, they're completely different. Sorry, I was being a bit... Was I being rude? I probably was being rude. We're still hungover from last night. You know, the question should not be, should we pick or should we not? If it is, then you get into your problem. What are we going to pick? It's about directionality, which is that you're not pissing in the wind, again, in the Keith Pavitt sense. You're making particular, you're moving things in particular directions. And how can we get a framework which allows us to think about directionality in more creative ways?
She left the easiest question to me. No, but I would like just to thank Stephany and Martin for their comments. And I think that you highlighted many different functions, but some of them, they cut across the four of that we have specified, especially the accumulating knowledge and brokerage role. They are part of each of them. But it's those are very good and valid points. And well, then, Mariana, we will have to discuss, because I tend to agree that contexts do matter, but not for the theoretical discussion, but when we go into the empirical discussion. So you have to take into account the institutional setting. So, and we actually did a bit of that in our other paper that is probably going to come out as a SPRU working paper, which is to compare KFW and the BNDS, so we give a background on the context and their trajectories and how these institutions were funded, the historical changes in what they did, and so on. Yes, wait a second, very interesting case. So what the winners are, I'm sorry, maybe it wasn't very clear, that's the definitional issue. You have a broad range that spans from components through firms to components, technologies, firms, industries, or whole missions. And right now, I think the definition of missions, for some contexts, they are quite obvious. For some, they are less obvious and requires a more democratic process to be defined. So about the methodology, I think that that's the key question. And one way to look at it is that we need, as a solution to the methodological problem, a similar methodology as neoclassical economics has provided for picking winners, which allows for ex ante evaluation of projects. Or you may have a methodology that looks at a posteriori what has happened. And we are right now at the moment looking at what has happened in a way that we will try to come up with lessons for this ex ante definition of what the state could do and go about. So yes, that's the challenge. We have come up with the table with some indicators that we want to collect to do this analysis of these historical cases. And hopefully it will develop into a methodology that can inform the policies that are required for those missions. So that's our ongoing work.
Just to be specific, what we did is we took the four different roles and divided it up between with each of those roles, whether it's the venture capital, the counter-cyclical, the capital development, the mission-oriented, how you might look at those in this more traditional perspective, what the questions would be, and the exact questions that policymakers would be asking themselves through this sort of what we call the market shaping framework. I'm not sure why we didn't put it up. I think it's because when we wrote a paper all around that table, we almost had a nervous breakdown, and we decided to forget about it. But that is the goal, and it's almost unfair that we didn't put it up. But the problem is that it got very, very detailed, and we didn't want sort of the discussion to be on the detail, but more on whether this is even an interesting way to sort of pose the question.
Would you like to make any comments?
Just briefly.
I think just one final comment from each of you and Martin. And I'm afraid we're not going to have time for additional questions.
So on this thing of the context, I mean, I think it's a really important question. I mean, I agree at one level with Mariana that you have to have a sort of in some ways similar approaches, but on the other hand, the kind of issues that a country like Mali has to solve are very different from the ones that the US has to solve. And even, I would say that the role that innovation has to play is different, because obviously, I mean, in Mali, you have to, you know, give electricity to a lot of people who don't even have it, you have to give them shoes, you know, basic needs. As Richard and others call that. And therefore, some of those aspects are, I think, in some ways simpler. And you don't, so I think we have to think about ways of adjusting the role of these development banks to the different categories of countries and of needs. And
isn't there lots of work already on that? Huge amount. I mean, isn't that what all the literature is focused on?
Not so much, because there isn't so much literature on development banks, for example, in low-income countries, as a mechanism for helping provide these goods. There is more, of course, on the middle-income countries, I would say. But we haven't found very much in this project. And there's a lot of prejudice against these development banks, in Africa. They say, you know, that they're all bad except possibly the South African Development Bank. I'm not so sure that is true. Yeah. And one of the things that I would say is very important always to compare development banks amongst each other as you're planning to, but also always with the private sector. So, you know, because the private sector has all these failures, gaps, doesn't have a strategic vision, and so on. And so again, if we're just looking at public banks, then we say, oh no, they're very bad because, as you say. So that's one. And one very last point, you asked about the political agenda. It's very interesting. Well, I think this gentleman may have left, that in the UK, the Labour government is talking actually a business investment bank. It's a bit too small, £3 billion pounds of capital, but it's there. But of course, it would be a small thing in the middle of this massive sea, a little island in the massive sea of private finance. But even here, you know, where the city is so dominant, you already start having this discussion. But in Germany, for example, it's a no-brainer. I mean, everybody's in favor, even the right is in favor.
Sorry, our whole point was not to look at the existence or not of state investment banks. It's precisely the question you're raising, which is how are they framed, what
exactly.
Is the position, and the British Investment Bank is completely, I mean, just read the material they produced, being justified through this extremely narrow framework.
Yeah, yeah.
So that the point is not to say, oh, look, how great, there's an investment bank. It's just, yeah. Hey, if you don't have the right framework, this is just going to actually lead to
marginal
situation, or
lack of ambition.
Great. Martin, we are out of time, but do you have a final point you want to make?
Let me just put the context thing just the other way around. I think why I was particularly interested and excited by what you're doing is because it has precisely the potential, but maybe in a different way, that you were talking about, of complementing the state in the area of innovation policy. Because by and large, the state in most of the countries I'm sort of thinking about is doing a crap job
Yeah, this concentration on R&D, you know, the default thinking is innovation, capacity, R&D. Oh, where? In a center of excellence. Yeah, and that's the driving force that is shaping, quotes, innovation capacity. It seems to me that state investment banks are potentially really important agents in, depending who you're talking to, either complementing that or offsetting that pattern of existing dominant processes of innovation policy development.
Context does matter. I mean, I was being a bit silly. But in fact, the reason we chose these four banks to focus on, a different paper actually focuses on just those four, was the context, but the common context compared to other banks. And the context was that these were banks in particular countries that had one thing in common, which is the Treasury was talking to the Ministry of Innovation. Okay, so here, you know, Osborne and Vince Cable, you know, literally have. Well, that is where you should go to see a psychotherapist. They have a very strange relationship. They don't know how to talk to each other. Even when they think they're talking to each other, they're not talking to each other. What you have in Brazil, and this also gets to your inclusion point, is you have an agenda which is all about smart growth and inclusive growth. And they have used these kind of banks precisely to try to tackle the two things at once, right? So when BNDES makes 21% return on equity through its portfolio, we're not going to pretend it's all from the innovation stuff, it's from this portfolio, which includes funding Petrobras, you know, that money, 80% of it goes to the Treasury, which gets reinvested into education and healthcare, right? So they're fascinating instruments of investment that by definition are looking at as a portfolio, and because they're being driven by this dual innovation poverty alleviation agenda, end up presenting really interesting cases to look at to ask those four questions that we are asking. And actually, the whole project began with the inclusive growth agenda. But can I just say thank you so much? I mean, we said that we were going to debrief afterwards, and I think the kind of comments that you provided and the few questions we were able to get have just been really, really, really extremely interesting. So thanks. And hopefully.
Otherwise, I'd ask you all to help me in thanking all four of the panelists.